Hi, I'm Crystal Stump, founder and CEO of ABC Consulting and former Virginia ABC Special Agent from the Alcoholic Beverage Control Authority. Today's video is going to talk about the five things you should know before you open a mobile bartending business. Pour yourself a drink, you're going to need it. And thank you so much for watching this video. If you are a future or current Virginia ABC licensee, please subscribe to this channel. We're going to be coming out with new videos each week on various license types and the alcohol regulations in Virginia to help keep you compliant and educate you on everything you need to know involving selling alcohol in Virginia. And if you're watching this video, we're going to talk about the five things you should know before you start that mobile bartending business. I know it's a hot business right now, and there's a lot of bartenders that, due to COVID, have had to find other ways to make money, and maybe it's something that they've always wanted to do is go out on their own and start their own business, and now is a great time to do that. Pretty soon, there's going to be a lot of people that have put off their wedding receptions and birthday parties and various private gatherings due to COVID, and they're all going to be wanting to have these events and have parties, and they're going to need these mobile bartenders available to come and help them with serving their guests and mixing drinks for them, and someone who is knowledgeable in this craft and in this skill. But if you're a good mixologist or a good bartender, you know, you also need to be familiar with how to operate and run a business. So that's what this video is going to cover: the five things you need to know before you start that mobile bartending business. And number one is going to be determining your legal entity and your trade name. So you need to come up with a name for this business first. And what I would recommend that you do is go straight to Google and start looking at, or GoDaddy.com, and start looking up domains and Google names that, domains that are available and Google names that are maybe not taken. So that way you can come up with something unique and different. And if you find that a domain name is available, go ahead and snag that domain name. They're not very expensive, and you want to get that right away, because lots of people will make a name for their business first, decide on the name of their business, and then they go to GoDaddy and look for a domain and realize that name's already taken. So do a little bit of homework before you decide on your name by seeing what's available on the domain search, and then Googling that name and looking on social media for that name and seeing if there's any other names like the one that you have in your mind, like the one that you have in mind. The next thing that I would recommend that you do is also check with the US Patent and Trademark Office. You want to make sure that the name that you're selecting and the design and the logo and everything for your name is not already taken. So you want to check that out after you decide on that name. And then the next part is going to be registering your legal entity, and also understanding the difference between your legal entity name and your trade name is very important. That's business 101. You have to understand that the legal entity name is your corporate name. It's the name that is either, if you decide to do an LLC, which has the owners are considered members in an LLC, or if you decide to do a corporation, those owners are considered officers, directors, or stockholders. So you want, that is your legal entity name. And pick something that is not complicated for that. If I could make a suggestion, it's going to save you a lot of heartache if you pick a legal entity name that is easy to spell, short, not long, because you're going to be using that legal entity name on all sorts of registrations and applications. And if you get that name wrong, you could be applying for a name that is not yours only because you're off by a letter, okay? So if, for example, if you're using a legal entity name that has the word West in it, don't abbreviate that, and make sure that you know that you haven't abbreviated it when you registered it, because when you go to do other registrations, those need to match exactly. And the ABC authority is very strict on that, as they should be, because your legal entity name as registered with the State Corporation Commission and with the IRS has to match all of your registrations. So when you pick that legal entity name, that's not really the time to be creative, and don't pick confusing names, okay? Now, your trade name is the name that everybody's going to know you as. The trade name is the name that is going to be on your sign, on your marketing material, on your social media page. And that trade name can be different than your legal entity name. And always seek an attorney for legal advice, but my recommendation would be that it be a different name. Your legal entity name could have multiple trade names associated with it. So you want to pick a trade name that everybody is going to be familiar with. The trade name is going to be what you have looked on the domain search and Google. That's what everyone knows you as. So once you determine your legal entity name and your trade name, you're going to want to register that with the Secretary of the state in which you're going to be doing business. And in Virginia, it's the Virginia State Corporation Commission. And if you need help doing any of these registrations, we can help you with that. We not only help businesses with getting an ABC license, but we can help with your SCC registrations, EIN, Virginia Sales and Use Tax, trade name, whatever registrations you need, we're more than likely going to be able to help you with that. So once you decide on that name, you're going to need to register that with the State Corporation Commission in the state in which you're doing business, and you'll register your legal entity name and also the trade name, if it's different than the legal entity name that you're going to be using. When you get those registered, the next thing that you're going to want to do is your EIN, your employer identification number. You'll register that through the IRS website, or we can help you do that as well. And once that is issued, you want to make sure that the address that is associated with that EIN number and name matches what you put with the State Corporation Commission. So everything needs to match, and it's very important. If you don't have attention to detail, you probably need to hire somebody to handle these things for you so it's all done perfectly. It's no fun going back and having to redo registrations with various agencies. It sometimes can be a nightmare, quite frankly. So you want to do it right the first time. The fifth and final thing that you need to know if you're going to be operating a mobile bartending business in Virginia is knowing the state rules and regulations. So if you are a Virginia bartender, you may or may not be state certified to sell and serve alcohol. And if you're not, I highly recommend that you consider Toast VA. The link is at the top of the screen. There's an online alcohol seller server training program there. Take that training. It is very Virginia specific, unlike my competitors. We talk about so many different things. We talk about how to prepare for your inspection, how to be an ABC manager, how to calculate ratio, so many different things than some of the generalized trainings out there. So if you're not very familiar with the ABC regulations, you definitely want to become very knowledgeable in all of the Virginia alcohol seller server training guidelines and the regulations. So you can take that online. The link, Toast VA, is at the top of the screen. Check that out. Once you have that state certification, you also need to know what type of licenses you need. And in Virginia, there is not, unfortunately, a mobile bartending license. So you cannot go to the Virginia ABC Authority and apply for a license that allows you to just travel around and sell alcoholic beverages as a mobile bartender, unfortunately. So you have to apply, you have to operate your mobile bartending business without selling alcohol, okay? And I know that can be challenging, but what has to happen is the event that you are working at, let's say that you have been hired to be the mobile bartender for a wedding reception. The wedding reception, depending on the venue, more than likely if they're hiring you, the venue does not have an ABC license, they don't have a restaurant, they don't have a bartender, they don't have that service. So the individual who's having the wedding reception will have to apply for a one-day banquet license. That license allows for the consumption of alcoholic beverages in that location. They can then hire you to go pick up the alcohol that's already been purchased by them. You can go pick it up, you can bring it there, and then you can mix and make the drinks and provide them to their guests. You can charge a fee for your mixers, your glassware, all of the other ingredients that go with making those cocktails, and a service for picking, a chauffeur service for picking up the alcohol and delivering it back to the license holder at the end of the night, and any of the consulting that you give that person. Obviously, you would charge for that. So you can write up a contract with your clients that indicate what all you're going to be doing for them, but you're not going to be able to go to, for example, Total Wine or to the liquor store, buy all of this alcohol and then resell it at that party. That is not allowed in Virginia. So you want to make sure that if you're going to be operating this business, that you understand that and that you know how to do it the right way. Now, we work with a lot of mobile bartenders in Virginia where we handle the licensing for their client. So if they sign a contract with someone saying that they're going to do the mobile bartending for them for their event, they usually get all of the information and we move forward with handling that license for them. And then when the license is approved, we make sure that the mobile bartender has a copy of that license because it does have to be posted where the alcohol is being served. And so if someone is having an event like that, it's kind of a lot going on with it. You have to have the one-day license. The mobile bartender is involved. There's usually caterers involved. There's the event planners involved. And we're just one more element in that where we handle the licensing part of it. So if you're considering opening or if you're operating a mobile bartending business and you want to talk to me about it in more detail, comment below or visit my website and reach out to me via email. I'd be more than happy to talk to you about this new adventure that you have. I wish you the best with this business. I think it's fantastic. I think it's a growing business and a wonderful business, but I want to make sure that you're educated on it and that you're going about and operating it the right way. Thank you so much for watching this video. I appreciate you watching. Comment below, subscribe, and I'll talk to you in the next video. Have a great day. Cheers.